Foreign businesses in the Philippines have been grappling with their own set of challenges during the Luzon-wide lockdown. With us now for more is the Executive Director of the German-Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Martin Henkelmann. Good to see you, Martin. Welcome to the program.
Thank you. Good to see you.
So how are Chamber members carrying on 3 weeks into the Luzon-wide lockdown?
Well, German-Philippine business, the business community is trying its best to cope with the challenges. Now we are in the third week of the lockdown, and the companies do what many other companies here do as well. Large part of them are in a total lockdown and a shutdown situation, and other work with skeleton workforce from home. And then we have many companies which are involved in the essential services or in essential products, production, manufacturing, and they try as well to go on, and they are frontliners there and do the best they can. And then we have BPO sector companies, large group, of course, very important group for us. And they had the advantage that they were quite well prepared, and they can put their labor force into a home office. And the fourth group I'm really worrying about is the manufacturing sector, which is orientated towards the export, and they have lots of problems to tackle a very difficult situation.
True. It's a whole lot of challenges as we enter the third week. So what are the key pain points still? What needs refining or addressing from the foreign investors' perspective as it relates to local jobs?
Yeah, the first point is that we see unclarity with regard to guidelines given. The implementation is not always stringent and consistent, so companies are challenged, lose time when trying to set up their mitigation plan and contingency plans to cope with the situation. So this is one of the big challenges. The second one is that even companies that want to work and want to go on, and even let's say they get the opportunity, get the permissions necessary, they have problems to get their employees to the working place as the public transport is shut down. So they have to look on organizing their own transport, or and hope that many of them have motorbikes that they can come, etc., to work. So this is a second large challenge. And then for the companies, it's as well the question of logistics. Companies that are in the essential service or produce essential goods, they still need ingredients to be transported to the factory, to the plant. And how do you get them there if companies and the logistics sector is stuck at checkpoints, or if the port doesn't work very strongly? These are some of the points. I have companies, a manufacturing company, for example, they have 200 people now living on the plant, on the site, because they couldn't find dormitories around, and they wanted to continue to export and to produce. And so they set up an own camp, of course, with new toilets, washing facilities, and an evening program for the workers to be in the factory.
Has there been no improvement? Because it's been clear that there have been a trouble at the start of the lockdown, but then that's been sort of smoothened out with the kinds of conversation that I've had with food manufacturers, for instance.
Yeah, I do agree. First of all, of course, we kind of point out what needs improvement, but we shouldn't forget how difficult the situation is and how disruptive the situation is. And there is no model that the government can just copy and say, we do this as we did 20 years ago. Every country at the moment is almost a laboratory, which tries to find the right way to balance this challenge between life and livelihood. And new measures have to be implemented and have to be seen on their effect. Not everything can be anticipated. I'm totally agreeing. And there have been lots of adjustment in the last weeks and days. And what we see as well, which is very important, we see lots of goodwill. And of course, administrative and civil servant, they are doing a great job, because they are frontliners as well. We shouldn't forget this as well. So we see the improvement there, and things for some part gets better. But nonetheless, to go up in productivity and the capacities, we still have a way to go.
Indeed, and policy responses have been swift, from the rate cuts to relaxed regulations to the stimulus law. How does the foreign investment community see themselves benefiting from these measures?
We see that these, once again, the guidelines get better, get relaxed, more clarified. That helps already a lot. And then, of course, if there are import duties lifted from medical products and pharmaceuticals, that helps us as well to get the products into the country and hopefully accelerating all the time at the port. When it comes to helping the companies with on the financial side, we have to see that many of the proposals so far aim at helping the poor and those who have lost their livelihood. And we totally do understand that this is a drama that needs help, that needs to be addressed strongly. And the government has done the first steps. And I think the speech of the president yesterday went in this direction. We totally agree. Now we have to look how we can strengthen the capacities of the companies. We have to see that they can continue to pay their workforce. And the second thing is that they are strong for the moment when the lockdown stops. At one time it will stop, and then they have to be back at a good strength to grab their markets, to get their markets back. And one point we would see more support, we would like to see more support, is perhaps the system on supporting employees that cannot work should go through the companies. Perhaps the companies should get a support that they continue to employ their employees, because then the employees stick with the companies. The company still has influence on them, can even perhaps put them into training at the moment. And the company can leverage what government gives by saying, government says, we give, I don't know, 60% of the salary, and the company continues to pay the other 40% of the salary. And then the day after everything gets better and we open again, the companies are back to normal, or faster back to normal. Otherwise, they would lose perhaps weeks by hiring people again. This would cost productivity, and this would be a pity if people that could already work wouldn't be in a job because the hiring process takes 2 weeks. So this is one of the aspects we would like to improve, to see more support there.
So are you needing more clarity as to the kinds of businesses that would help get that support in order to keep their workers?
Yeah, I think the package that the government set up is good in some points, but we have the impression that it's mainly aiming at the moment of helping individuals that lost their job. I think we should look more on the possibility of helping individuals, particularly those who had regular jobs, contracted, through the companies, and keeping employees and companies together. Besides this, the companies will have, certainly many of them will have a cash flow problem in not so much time. This is clear as well. So we should see if there can be support for the companies with regard to this. And we shouldn't forget the export industry, how hard they will probably be hit. Many of our companies produce not only for China or the Asian market, which might recover a little bit, but many of our companies are more looking towards the US and Germany and the European market. And when you see where the US is at the moment on the crisis scala and the European market, then you see that even if at one time they might be opening the factories here again, the market might not be there yet.
As you await for clarity on the businesses that it could help, what's the workaround? What are the chamber members and investors, foreign investors, doing with the current staffing? Are they holding staff, or are they letting some of them go?
Most of the companies really committed themselves to hold staff as long as possible. And I think many of them, particularly for the first year, 4 weeks, for this first period, I hope it will be the only one, although I already say first period, for this week until after Easter, most of them holding on their staff. They have supported them by also paying out part of the 13th salary and bonus, overpay, all that what can be possible, credits from vacation. All this has been given. And we had a webinar from the chamber 2 days ago, and we had more than 350 people listed up there. It was about HR issues at the moment of the crisis, and you see how big the interest is there to find the possibilities to use as good as possible the programs of the government, and on the other side to see how what could be the best practice for the companies to hold on with their staff, and how they can integrate. Training was an issue that was discussed there. How can they train people for the time after the crisis and for the new jobs? Because much more jobs will be probably in front of the screen.
So there is an assurance that the companies, the foreign companies, will be able to hold on to their staff, but only until mid-April. But big question arises right after April 12th.
I, of course, cannot guarantee for all the German or European companies, but there is strong commitment also from the headquarters in Europe, which very often have this tradition as well, that you hold on to your stuff and do whatever is possible. And I think the problem is not so much during this time. There is a problem already, but the bigger problem will come certainly if we have another 4 weeks or 6 weeks or 8 weeks of lockdown. Then the situation gets of course more and more difficult, particularly on the cash flow sides from company. That's obvious. Yeah.
That's true. Either way, the economy is going to slow. The Economic Planning Secretary Ernesto Pernia even flagging on this program a potential technical recession. In what way does that impact the investment prospects in the Philippines for German investors?
Yeah, at the moment, of course, the forecast is not very, very strong, and for the Philippines and for almost no place in the world. We really have to see how long the crisis will be and how strong the measures the governments all over the world take to come out of this bad situation, perhaps even to avoid recession or at least keep recession low and short. And then of course companies will look afterwards again, where are the strong markets? Where's growth? And the Philippines have been very strong in the last 8 years with 6% and more. On the growth side, and particularly for consumer goods, have been very interesting market, but also with the build program. So I think there is this chance to attract investors afterwards. Once again, we have to see that the structure here is kept as strong as possible for the moment after the crisis. That companies, when they look around from Europe and they look, where do I invest now, or which market is solid, where should I do my next steps to gain money again, that they think quickly about this great, interesting market here in the Philippines with 106 million inhabitants and a strong, growing middle class.
Are there any chamber members, Martin, involved in producing integrated circuits or components for medical equipment?
We have quite a lot of pharmaceutical companies here active. How far they are enlarging their production here at the moment, I'm not aware of this. I know that there was contact with the textile sector, if they could get involved in the production manufacturing of PPE and mask. I think these are ways the government should really explore to see. There's so much know-how, and the textile sector is one that's probably very hard hit by the crisis. As consumption goes down in Europe at the moment, and lots of them have been manufacturing for Europe and for the US, so this could be at least a win-win situation to give opportunities to these companies. But I think there's a second point besides these companies which are active at the moment in the essential business. The government should look as well if how far they could perhaps liberalize or open up a little bit more the e-commerce sector to get more goods out there and create jobs for hundred thousands or thousands of drivers, delivery service, because e-commerce is one that in Europe works very well. And by definition, e-commerce is already physical distancing and no people on the streets and crowding together and gathering together.
Martin, final point, is the foreign business community prepared for an extension or expansion of the lockdown? Nothing's decided yet, but the health department's been asked to give its assessment to the interagency task force.
A part of the business model of every company, small, middle size or big, is to be prepared for the worst and hoping for the best. And I think lots of preparation has been done. As you said, the processes got smoother, IDs have been issued, authentication, there is more experience now, so this will certainly help. I think they will just take up this challenge and do the best what they can to make their business run and to keep their employees.
All right. Well, thank you so much for giving us a look-see into the challenges of the foreign business community. Martin, keep well. Martin Henkelmann of the German-Philippine Chambers of Commerce and Industry.